today we are talking about why. And as you may remember, recently I did a video giving a shout out to Dr. Les Carter about his video on August 3rd about the one question that a narcissist runs from, and it is that question, why? Narcissists do not think self-reflectively. They don't think to understand or try to understand themselves, much less anybody else they interact with. They're justified in their own head in everything they say and do. And they are also very spontaneous, short, quick thinkers that have already made up their mind about the way the world is and the way the world sees them. And they cannot let anyone penetrate or break down the walls that they have up to protect that inner child, that three-year-old toddler self that they are in the interior of their soul and their heart. They're reactors and they're immediate thinkers. They're not self-reflective. They don't spend any more time than a split second thinking about whatever's happening in the moment and whatever they can do or say to get to the next immediate supply that they're going to be getting from the outside world. So every moment of their lives, and this is what's so pitiful and sad, they are constantly on high alert, trying to take in and take advantage of an opportunity, any given opportunity that might pop up that puts them in their minds in a superior position. They always, always, and that's the whole premise of narcissistic personality disorder, they're always thinking that they're a lower person in society, that society is here and they're one down from the rest of society. And so they're constantly in everything they're doing and saying and achieving in their life, everything is about trying to one-up the next person. It doesn't matter who it is. It does not matter. So circling back to that point of asking this question, why, they're not reflective thinkers. They don't spend any time thinking, like in any given incident, whether it was inappropriate or appropriate, where they said the wrong thing, where the conversation went wrong, why the argument happened in the first place, why there's a conflict. It doesn't even cross their mind. It does not matter to them. It's moot to them. They don't even get to the point where they say, why did that happen? I guess it doesn't matter because I'm happy with myself. Let's move on. They don't even go that far. It just does not matter. Nothing is why. That's what Dr. Carter was talking about. Narcissists tuck tail and run for the hills. They cannot answer the question why. Whereas the rest of us, somewhat normal people, are always trying to think about our relationships and evaluate our relationships and understand other people and understand how we impact others and how others impact us. And we're always trying to make sense of everything around us and how things interact so that we can understand and function in our relationships better. At least I know when I got out of my narcissistic abuse situation, that work situation that I referenced so much in my videos, that was the triggering experience that brought me back to awareness of my childhood and my upbringing. The 1 year that passed from the time I left that job to the time I actually sought counseling was spent me trying to figure out what the heck happened in that situation, why it all happened. And honestly, I have spent so much time thinking about why. It's exhausting. And why, what the heck was that 5 years? I mean, that 5 years, I was in such a state of confusion and just high strung atmosphere. I got to the point where I just finally had to leave. And like I've mentioned before, I wasn't even able to tell my husband why. Like, he asked me one day, are you sure this is what you want to do? You have a good job there. It's a good position. It's a good future, all this other stuff. And I'm like, I can't even explain it to you. I have got to leave because I couldn't. I really couldn't. I just knew I had to. I knew I had to. But then I spent an entire year going back over everything that happened and evaluating everything and observing from a distance, like on social media and stuff like that, the interactions between people. And they were so fake and they were so filled with fake puffery, like, oh, we're best friends and all, the office is so great and blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, wait, when I was there for 5 years, it was nothing but, oh, I want to scratch her eyes out. And I want to scratch her eyes out. And I was like, oh my gosh, can't we all just get along? And I always wondered, what the heck is going on? And truthfully, the bottom line is I was always asking myself why while I was there. And I was always confused while I was there why this drama had to happen and why these conflicts had to happen and why people just couldn't behave professionally, respectfully, and courteously. We were a small office of like 7 or 8 people. And a couple of us got along really well, fine, no issues. But then there were just a couple of people that were just like, and it was like, oh my gosh, you guys, we are supposed to be professionals. We're trying to grow the company. We're trying to put out a positive vibe. We're trying to, but here's what I've learned since I've left that job and that company is it is a fallacy. The entire company is just a facade. And I never knew that when I was there. I believed that what we were doing was good. I had a positive attitude. I was very engaged and very enthusiastic. And it was me being in that environment and why I just got beat down is because everything was a fallacy. And I think because I spent so much time going back and pondering the whys of everybody else's behavior as well as my own, I just kept coming up against this brick wall in my desperation by that point to understand what had happened so that I could grow and learn. Because what a waste of time if I came out of that 5-year experience and hadn't learned or grown for the next job opportunity. You know, it would have been a complete waste had I went through that whole experience and come out of it on the other end with no understanding. Like, so I spent a year going back over everything and writing notes and going back through my notes and going, yeah, that happened. Yeah, that happened. Yeah, I remembered that accurately. Yeah, I communicated myself accurately. Yeah, I sought out a 45-year veteran certified HR professional as a mentor for counseling and for reading my memos and proofing them and letting me know, giving me her professional feedback. And because as a side note, remember, I was in HR. So, you know, here I was going, I think that I behaved well. I think that I managed myself well. I think I behaved respectfully towards everybody and professionally. And so I kept coming to this brick wall going, okay, I still don't understand. I'm not getting anywhere at all. And that was when I finally went to the counselor and went, why? You know, because I couldn't heal and I couldn't understand the bitterness and the hurt and the resentment and the anger and all the stuff that I was still carrying. I couldn't do anything with it. There was nothing to be done. I just kept coming to a dead end. I wasn't growing. I wasn't healing. Nothing was happening. I was seeking understanding and not finding it for over a year. And so finally, when I went to the counselor and the very first words out of his mouth were something about my childhood, I went, what? What are you talking about? Like, wait a minute, stop. We gotta back up here, huh? So literally, like, the first session I had with him, I was like, what? Seriously? Wow. And at the same time, I was going, was that my childhood? So therapy, of course, introduced this whole concept of you're struggling right now in your life and you're wondering why and you're not understanding why it's these problems are persisting, this stress, this anxiety, this frustration. And you're studying the problem deeply. You're going back over, you're ruminating about it. You're trying to figure out, trying to get answers, trying to get clarity, trying to seek understanding about whatever is going on, and you're not getting anywhere. And then through counseling, through seeking professional help from a good counselor, they introduce this concept of, well, let's just table your current problem and go way back to the very beginning, as far back as you want to go, to like what might be an indicator of why this bothers you so much. You know, are there other things in your past that could have contributed to your susceptibility to be a victim of this behavior or that behavior, or why you might not understand this because you were raised to believe this other way, or you know what I'm getting at. So it was only through counseling where I finally transitioned and got that I couldn't spend any more time dwelling on the current problem and trying to understand the current problem, because it had nothing to do with the current problem. And it took me a year and a half of counseling and a lot of research myself, to both professional research and personal research on my past and thinking and studying. And that's why it was a painful process. But counseling was that first step I needed to take. How were you raised? How were you raised? What kind of environment were you raised by and in? What were your parents like? Did you have both a mother and a father, or two dads and two moms, or however, you know, what was your household? Who were you raised by? Were you raised by your grandparents, your aunts, your uncles, your cousins, you know, foster family, you know, were you adopted? You know, who were you raised by and how were you raised? Was it a troublesome childhood? Was it fraught with neglect and manipulation and abuse and physical violence and abandonment and all these other issues? Were you unsafe? Were you unfed? Were you hungry? Did you not sleep at night? Did you not get medical care? So on and so forth. There are so many different reasons why children grow up to be adults that have struggles with their adult life. So I can honestly say, based on my own experience, that if you are asking yourself why, that's another clue. You're not the narcissist. They're the voice in your head making you doubt yourself, and you're back in your own quiet space in the bathroom or the shower going, why? Why did that just happen? Why did that blow up? How did that get out of control? The minute you find yourself self-reflecting, hello, there you go. You're not the narcissist, okay? So stop thinking that. Don't go there. Don't let them get in your head. Keep a clear head. Keep a clear head. Keep a clear head. So it is worth, in my opinion, to self-reflect and spend some time asking why. But when you find yourself hitting a brick wall, that is definitely the time to seek counseling if you haven't already, because the question why is extremely important. And if you're not getting any clarity about your current situation, it's because there's something more to the story than what you're aware of. And you need a professional's help to help you, to help hold your hand and walk with you through this pain and stress and suffering and antagonism you're dealing with at this adult stage of life. You shouldn't have to do it alone. You know, we find ourselves as victims, I think, of narcissistic abuse and bullying and other kinds of abuse, asking ourselves why when the others are not also asking themselves why. In my experience, when you ask yourself why, and you go back through and you do the self-evaluation and you answer the questions why, and you get to a place where you're like, I feel like I've done my best to grow and improve the situation. I'm hitting a brick wall. Why am I still coming up? Why is this conflict still existing? It's because of the other players in the conflict, whether it be a one-on-one conflict or you seemingly against the world or several other people, whether it's a club or a church situation or whatever. You are dealing with multiple people, perhaps, that are the problem, or one person that's the problem and some enablers, depending on the situation, because it could be just one person that is the primary problem and the peripheral people in the group are just enablers. They don't understand narcissism or manipulation or adult bullying, or they just don't have the time or capacity to deal with it. So you've got you, who wants to understand and wants to grow and wants to improve relationships, who's banging their head against the wall and is asking themselves the question why and trying to understand everything and why the conflict's happening in the first place. And you just keep hitting a brick wall, and the conflict continues to happen. And you're like, why is it? Is it just me? Is it that I'm not just forgiving and forgetting and turning the other cheek? Or, you know, because then, you know, of course, you know, then you will be accused of being too abrasive and too sensitive and because you have boundaries and you know what's the difference between what's right and what's wrong. And there's this line that should not be crossed where people should be treated with respect and courteous. And there is a way to do it. And you don't have to feel like you're kissing each other's butt. You don't have to feel like you're walking on eggshells. It's just being courteous. You're just like, okay, stop everything in its tracks. And you have to go back into your own past, examine your own childhood, like I mentioned, who you were raised by, who you were raised with, who were the major influences in your life. Like for me, it was my mom and dad and my two oldest brothers. And then at what point in your life you remembered or noticed a significant change in how you felt as a person about who you were. So with that said, keep asking that question, why? It's a good question to ask. And always, always, always take care of you. Bye for now.